All right, guys, welcome to your last asynchronous lecture before spring break. You are going to need handout 7, and we're going to actually get started with a little bit of jazz. This excerpt is going to go by really quickly, so I'm going to play it for you a couple of times, but let's go ahead and give a listen to the little bit of music you have at the top of your handout. Okay, I told you it went by quickly. Let's listen to it one more time. And what I want you to focus on is when you actually get a sense of B minor in the solo. All right. Now, looking at the score you have in front of you, and from what you just heard, I think that we'd probably be in agreement that measure 5 is when it feels like the solo really settles into B minor, maybe a smidgen before with the B at the end of measure 4 right there. But right here at 5, when we arpeggiate the B minor triad, that's where we really kind of settle into B minor as a key. Now let's look at what is going on in those first 4 measures. Now, if I were to put a mirror right there, can we use that D as kind of a central point? Looking at this opening lick, we're in all eighth notes and we get this huge agogic accent right on this D sharp. I want us to work backwards in both directions from that D sharp. So what I mean by that is working backwards here, we've got F natural. Working forwards, we have F natural. Then we have A sharp, A sharp, C natural, C natural. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but if we were to continue all the way to the last beat of measure 4 and the first beat of the tune, you would find that the pitches are a mirror image of one another. Now, I am in no way suggesting that this is a serial piece at all, but this opening 4 measures are a really great visual representation of something we're going to be exploring for the next several classes, which is this idea of tone rows within a compositional practice called serialism. Now, in the 1920s, Schoenberg developed this technique. In a nutshell, this is a very watered down version of it. Composers design what we call a tone row. And a tone row is a series of all 12 chromatic pitches. Now you can go in any order you want, but the rule is you have to go through all 12 of them with no repeating. That makes up your tone row. Now, in a composition that is utilizing serialism, you have to play through that entire row before you can start again. So you've got to hit all 12 chromatic pitches in the order of your row before you can move on and start the next row. That is a very kind of strict presentation of the pitch, but other elements, rhythm, register, timbre, et cetera, those can all change. If you're thinking about, especially my composition people, ways to make the row sound interesting or make different presentations of the same row sound different, you have all of these elements at your disposal. So going back to this jazz tune then, if we start from the first pitch, I'm going to put PC integers on the first measure, on the first 2 measures. And I would encourage you to do it with me. Now those first 2 measures, we have 12 pitches, And if you go through those 12 in sequence, you will see that we have hit every single one of the chromatic aggregate without repeating anybody. Once we get to that last pitch, which is PC3, the D sharp, we then go in reverse and go through the entire chromatic aggregate, again, landing on PC11, the B natural, at the end. So we have this presentation of a tone row, and then a presentation of it that is backwards. There's actually a term for that, which is this one. So if we're talking about this tone row, the first presentation of a tone row in a serial piece is what we call the prime row. And we label it with a P, capital P, and a little subscript. You've gotten really used to these subscripts by now. The subscript gives you the PC integer of the first pitch. So if we were to label this row then, we would label as P and subscript either 11 or E. You will see them both out in the wild. Now, composing an entire piece based on a single row in that specific iteration is really challenging. It can be very difficult to create variation. So composers have given themselves a couple of tactics to keep things interesting, to manipulate the prime row so that they get some different sounds. The easiest way is by transposition. So we could take this P11 row here, and if we perform a T1 on it, we could do the same thing a half step higher. Inversion, and we will explore that in depth, but you can invert your row to give you a different interval palette. Retrograde is what we see here. So that simply means going backwards. So we see that with this half of the row. And then retrograde inversion is going backwards through an inverted row. Now, the specific way that a composer constructs their row has really important implications for its sound. This little snippet you have here is the prime row for Berg's Violin Concerto. So looking at it really quick, we could put a label on it. If this is the prime row, we're going to call it P, and its subscript is going to be the PC integer of the first pitch. So it starts on G, so we would refer to this as P7. Now, let's take a look at how this is structured. Right off the bat, we get what we would likely refer to as a G minor triad. So this row opens. Now, I want to share that D. And if we walk that up the next two notes of the row, now we have outlined a D major triad. That's interesting in and of itself, but it also gives Berg the opportunity to really imply tonality, because you've got G minor. You share that D, turn it into D major. All of a sudden, it kind of sounds like 1 in 5. Now let's kind of keep doing the same thing. If we share the A, now we've outlined an A minor triad. And let's share the E. That gives us E major. So the first 9 notes of this row, when you share that every third pitch, spin out 4 consecutive triads that are major and minor in quality. Now let's look at the last 4 notes. I am going to share the B. And they might look a little funky, but I'm going to play them for you. That hopefully sounds familiar and brings you back to week two of the semester. This row ends with a little bit of whole tone one. We've gone through all 12 pitches. We have not repeated any one, but Berg has manipulated those 12 pitches in a way that gives him a very distinct color palette, a very distinct way of adjusting the sound and making it potentially sound quite tonal. Now let's contrast that with a piece that I don't think anyone is going to say sounds very tonal. Let's give a listen to this. We're going to listen to the opening couple of measures of this song by Webern. This is from his Opus 25 Lieder. And let's just give it a listen. If we're talking about this in class, we could spend tons of time talking about the motivic use in the piano, the rhythmic motives, but it's serialism day. We're going to stick to just the pitch content. Now, I mentioned that oftentimes the first tone row of the piece is what we call the prime row. I'm going to couch that in a slight caveat, which is that sometimes it's hard to tell what specifically is going on in the first row in order to develop a tone row. And what I mean by that is we have this thorny issue of simultaneity. So our piano introduction presents itself initially as completely linear, but then we get this chord right here. If I am trying to build a tone row, if I'm trying to come up with my 12 consecutive pitches, I have no idea what order to put those four notes in. Obviously, Webern did, but I, the mere theorist, have no idea. So one way to circumvent that is to start our analysis with a row that has no simultaneities or a part that has no simultaneities. That is where the lovely vocalist comes in. Since singers can only make one noise at a time, one note at a time, we're going to take the vocal line first, and we are going to call that our prime row. You are absolutely okay to do that. All of the rows that you find are still going to be related to one another in the same way. You're just going to have different labels than perhaps another theorist or another analyst might have. And that is absolutely okay. So we are going to call this our prime row. And since it starts on G natural, which is PC7, we will call this P7. Can you take a moment and put PC integer labels on the other 11 pitches in this phrase, please? Okay, if you were to go through this collection of notes, you would find that you have 12 distinct pitches. You have one instance each of every PC from 0 to 11. So this is our prime row for this piece. Now, we know that there are different manipulations that we can do to this row. We can have it backwards, which we will call retrograde. We can have it in inversion, and we can have it in retrograde inversion. So you, as someone who is being tasked with doing a preliminary row counting analysis for this, you now have to figure out what to label the rest of these presentations. And it's really hard to hold all of that in your head. So that brings us to the third page of your handout, which right now looks like a lot of empty boxes. I present to you a tone row matrix. What this matrix is, you have the uppermost and lowermost rows and the left and rightmost columns are for your labels. The interior 144 boxes are for all of the possible iterations of the 12-tone row. We are going to not fill out this entire thing. There are websites that do that for you, like this one right here, which is a great website. I am not going to make you derive an entire matrix. It's not a good use of your time, but we are going to derive all four possible forms of a single row so that you understand how a matrix is developed. So we are going to start with our P7, our prime row. So the way a matrix is constructed, all of your prime rows are read left to right with their labels running down the leftmost column. We are going to take all of the PC integers of our P7 and just place them one integer per box in this first row of the matrix. So go ahead and transfer those PC integers down to, go ahead and transfer those PC integers down to this matrix and then come back and check when you're done. All right, so you have P7 now written out. If we were to read this row in retrograde, read it backwards and or read it right to left, that would give us our retrograde version of the row. So we will start our retrograde labels in the rightmost column. Now, labeling for retrograde rows is a little bit tricky. We label our prime rows with a subscript that indicates the first pitch. It is very tempting then to label your retrograde row here as R8, but we want to reflect in the retrograde label the prime row to which it is paired. So your retrograde label is going to have the same subscript as the prime label. So this row will be R7 because it is the retrograde of P7. Okay, writing the prime row is pretty easy. Labeling the retrograde row, pretty easy. The legwork comes in deriving the inverted row. And we label the inverted rows as I with a subscript that matches the first pitch. So we're going to derive I7. Now, inversions, in essence, we're doing everything upside down, right? Now, the PCs actually make this a little bit easier. When you go onto matrix generators on the interwebs, you often have an option to use PCs or letter names. Go ahead and do whichever is most comfortable for you. But I do actually think that inverting with PCs is easier, but to each their own. So how do we derive this inverted row? We basically do arithmetic in reverse. And what I mean by that is let's look at our first two integers of P7. We have 7 to 4. The mathematical relationship there is you subtract 3. To find the inversion, you're gonna do the exact opposite. You're gonna add 3. So the second note of I7 is going to be PC10. Then we go to the next pair of notes. 4 to 3, we went down by 1. So we are going to do the opposite, go in the opposite direction by the same amount. We're going to add 1. That gives us 11. You are going to keep doing that until you have completed the row. Once you've completed the row, go back and check. You should have one instance of each PC from 0 to 11. So go ahead and fill out the rest of I7. Check to make sure you have one PC from 0 to 11, and then come back and double check to see if your I7 matches mine. Okay, one instance each of PCs 0 through 11. No repeats, nobody's missing, we're good to go. The hardest part about deriving an inversion row is honestly just not losing your place. That's the biggest annoyance of it. Okay, we have one last row form to label, and that is the retrograde inversion. So your inverted rows are going to be over the top, and your retrograde inversions are labeled at the bottom. The same rule applies for labeling your RIs, your retrograde inversions, in that you don't label it by the PC of the first pitch. You label it by the PC of its partner inversion row. So this then would be RI7. Okay, so we've derived a little bit of a matrix. We've derived enough of a matrix to know what's going on. Now, we're going to come back to the score. We have P7 labeled. What I would like us to do is go about the process of figuring out what on earth is going on in the piano part. Now, let's take a look at the piano introduction. I'm going to do some quick counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So there are 11 notes in this piano introduction. You can't start a row in the middle. So we're going to go ahead and work on the assumption that we begin at the beginning of a row. And once we get through it, we're going to have a better understanding of what that 12th pitch is. But for right now, can you please put PC integers on all of the 11 pitches in the piano introduction, and please take care of what clef you're in. Okay, so we still have this simultaneity here that was problematic enough for us developing the very first row that we just skipped it and figured we'd come back to it. Now that we have even just that little corner of the matrix worked out, we have enough information to figure out what is going on in this particular row and how to label it. And the only information we need is we can start with just the very first interval class. So this row begins 6 down to 5. We have a PC6 going to PC5. Now, of course, it doesn't actually go down in the score, but we are talking solely about PC integers, not register or octave. So 6 down to 5. Cool. Let's go to the matrix. P7. 7 down to 4. Now, any transposition level that we would do to this row would still have that same 3 semitone interval at the beginning, or the same IC3 at the beginning. Since we know that, we can, in essence, completely eliminate prime row as an option for this piano introduction. I'm actually just going to write the first few PCs up here so that I don't have to keep scrolling up. So we have 6, 5, and 2 as the first 3 pitch classes of the introduction. So we know that because all prime rows are going to start with IC3, that there's no way that the piano introduction is a prime row. Similarly, all of the inverted rows, all of our I rows, are going to also start with interval class 3. So we can eliminate the I row forms as an option for the piano intro as well. So now we are simply working with the possibility of a retrograde or a retrograde inversion row. Now, sometimes you will need to wander further into the row than the first three pitches, but we only really need those first three notes to tell us what we need. And that is, we need interval class, and we also are going to take contour into account. And again, I don't mean contour on the score. I mean direction on the pitch clock face. So our introduction goes 6 to 5 and 5 to 2. So down by 1, down by 3. Let's look at the retrograde row. 8 to 9, okay, we're going up by 1. 9 to 0, we're going up by 3. And again, I'm talking just clockwise movement on the clock face. So the size is correct, 1 and 3, but the direction is wrong. Which brings us to, ta-da, the RI form. 6 to 5, down by 1. 5 to 2, down by 3. It just so happens that it is actually RI7 that opens the piece. We got lucky with that row form, and we have it right here spelled out for us. Now, this also highlights what happened to the 12th pitch. If we take RI7 and we follow it all the way to the end, the very last pitch of RI7, of course, is PC7 because it's a retrograde row. So let's go back to the score. I'm going to go ahead and block this off and label it as RI7. And look what happens. It's almost like, I don't want to call it a pivot because that is borrowing language from a different practice, but just like how Berg did these little repetitions of sorts where every third note was behaving duplicitously, it was kind of doing double duty. This PC7 right here is doing the same thing. So the last note of RI7 is behaving simultaneously as the first note of P7. And it's not just in the vocal line. We can actually even kind of expand this bracket and say, that we are sharing that PC7 among three different simultaneous rows. Now, with that knowledge, so this PC7 is also acting as the first note of the next row in the piano. So what I'd like you to do is, through the end of this excerpt, you have two more presentations of two different rows that are presented. So could you please walk through the rest of this excerpt? First step, put PCs on everybody. Second step, refer to your matrix and see if you can figure out what rows are in action. If your potential row is not on your matrix, that means you might have to do some deducing, but I think you'll be fine. Go to it, come back, we'll check our work. Okay, I went ahead and highlighted the labels for the row forms just so it's a little easier for you to find them. My score is getting a little chaotic. So the first row form in the piano after the introduction is, in fact, P7, it is the same row as the vocal line is performing. And some of you might have kind of just picked that up even after the first couple of notes, because it's right on top, right? And then once you complete P7, which ends with PC8 right here, your next row form, again, you got these pesky clef changes, but your next row form begins with PC6, and then you have, again, this simultaneity, this chord of four PCs all at once. What I actually probably ended up doing, and I genuinely can't remember at this point, but once you label the rest of the row, you have the last several pitches in order, right? We have no chords here. These are all in order. So you can find that on the matrix and sort of work backwards from the back of the row, since you don't really have a clear idea of who the second member of this row is because of the chord that happens right after PC6. So you can just work backwards and go to your matrix and say, okay, what row ends with 7TE? And in fact, the row that ends with 7TE and does indeed start with 6 is RI7. So this piece is saturated with very limited row forms, which is part of the reason that I chose it for this lecture, because there's not a ton in terms of hunting that you have to do. Now, I want to be really clear that doing a row counting on a piece is not full-on analysis. And I say that not to be grumpy, but it's similar to putting Roman numerals on a tonal piece. Once you put the Roman numerals on, yes, you've done some foundational legwork, but the analysis itself, the magic doesn't come from the Roman numerals. The magic comes from all the connections you can draw using the Roman numerals as one informant for your discussion. The same applies for this music. So yes, we've done the row counting. And if we were to continue to do it, we would then have all kinds of data in terms of what the pitch content is. That in and of itself is not the analysis, though. All of the magic happens when you take that data and you start to draw connections and you start to postulate about what it all means. So I really want to continue to stress that through the rest of this unit, that And I absolutely admit the vast amount of legwork that you do to get to this point is incredibly valuable, but the analysis really doesn't start until after that, which is a pain because you have done a lot of work. But the analysis is everything that you do with that information. That's where all of the interesting and cool stuff really happens. Okay, we will have a little worksheet to do for this. This is a kind of oddly timed lecture. So you might be listening to this pre-spring break. You might be listening to it the day after spring break or sometime in the middle. I wanted to give you guys some autonomy and also just a week off of classes, even though the college is still running and functioning. So worksheet available for this. Go to it if you like. And we will spend the last week of this unit exploring two different serial pieces, and one of your options for Capstone 2 has serial elements. So Britten's A Poison Tree. It is not a serial piece, but it does start with a tone row and the vocal line manipulates that row. So now that you have this information, if you would like to do the Britten for your Capstone, you have some tools in your toolbox. All right. Thank you so much, guys. I look forward to seeing you at last after spring break.